Good afternoon, students. Today we are going to have a lecture on employment opportunities in poultry disease diagnosis for young veterinarians. I would like to tell you that in this era of competitiveness, it is very important for all of us to be a little self-reliant, Atmanirbhar, the very initiative which is started by the government of India. If you look at this initiative, it has become very important to attain a growth, to attain a certain level of, enhancement in your career. You need to be a little self-reliant on yourself. And for this purposes, ICR has started up this initiative under which we are going to have a talk on employment opportunities in poultry disease diagnosis for young veterinarians. And for that, Dr. Milind Chavak, he is a general manager, Venkateshwara Hatchery Limited, Pune. It's one of the largest poultry conglomerate in Asian subcontinent. And he's currently heading the technical services part of that particular company. Dr. Chavak is a graduate of Nagpur Veterinary College. He received his master's degree in poultry science from Mumbai Veterinary College. And thereafter, he has attained his PhD from Indian Veterinary Research Institute, IVRI, in avian diseases. He was a recipient of ICR Junior Research Fellowship during his PhD program. And he has also worked as a scientist in ICR, particularly in Project Directorate of Poultry at Hyderabad. After working for 9 years, he joined Venkateshwara Hatcheries as a chief technical person, as a general manager. And since then, he's associated with Venkateshwara Hatcheries, giving all his input in the form of technical services at India as well as at global level. And he's currently holding a post of Secretary, World Poultry Science Association, one of the great association of poultry health science at a global level. And he has also has a credit of acting as an reviewer for many articles, both at international as well as at a national level. I'll go a little bit on that company with whom he is affiliated to. It's a Venkateshwara Hatchery Group of Company. It is a largest company, I would say, in the field of poultry science, in the field of poultry health, dealing A to Z of poultry. And they have a very standard, well, up-to-date modern laboratories with them. And he is currently, he is associated with Poultry Disease Research Center. And the beauty of this company is that they have a great satellite laboratory services all across our country. And so today, Dr. Chavak, he is going to talk on the aspect of poultry disease diagnosis as an avenue for I would say entrepreneurship. And so I welcome Dr. Chavak to deliver his talk. So Dr. Chavak, now the stage is on to you. So please, Dr. Chavak.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. So today's topic is employment opportunities in poultry. This is diagnosis for young veterinarians. Yeah, the content of my presentation is a review of Indian poultry industry and about Venkateswara Hatcheries Group, what we are doing and challenges for poultry industry and career opportunities for young veterinarians. The role of veterinarians in lab diagnosis and about, in brief, about poultry disease diagnosis, role of nutrition and feed in poultry farming, genetics and breeding, how development of hybrids and managemental practices, how it is related to career opportunities for young veterinarians. So when we see regarding poultry industry globally, there are major structural changes. So always introduction of modern intensive production methods and genetic improvements are always there. There is a lot of scope in improved prevention of control measures. Of course, if you see the yearly basis, there is always improvement in prevention and control measures of various diseases. And because of welfare practices or welfare measures they are considering, there are a lot of changes in intensive production methods also. If you consider India, it's emerged as one of the fastest poultry sector in the world. There is a transformation in last 20 years, and it has transformed from traditional backyard activity into major profitable commercial activity. At present, it's number three in egg production. It's around 83 billion eggs per year, and it's number three in chicken meat production also, producing almost 4.5 million metric tons per year. So if you see these top egg producing countries worldwide, China, of course, it's first, then US is second, and India, it's a third country. And meat production also, after China and United States, it's about third number. And the data is FAO statistics, March 2019. It is achieved by scientific managemental practices. Of course, basically breeding companies, they have got good breeding programs so that they have produced good breeders as well as commercial chickens, which are acclimatized to Indian conditions, and role of housing, feed formulations, and then disease diagnosis, control and prevention of diseases is always there. When we talk about Venkateswara Hatcheries Group, basically Venkateswara Hatcheries Group, I'm very happy to say that we are employing almost more than 500 veterinarians in our group. And basically success of our group is in pure line breeding programs for commercial broilers as well as commercial layers. We have developed commercial broilers like Venkop 400 and Venkop 430. And they are very well acclimatized to Indian conditions, and they are good producers of chicken meat and having good livability also. In layers, BV300 breed, it's producing almost 330 birds in 62 weeks production time and having very good acclimatization in Indian conditions as well as having good livability also. We are third largest SPF egg producers in the world, having production facilities in India and USA. We are giving technical services to poultry farmers through PDRC and satellite laboratories, which are located all over India. We are one of the top 10 poultry vaccine producers in the world. And we have made advancement in food processing, egg processing, and nutraceuticals also. We have got dedicated research and development team in the field of genetics and breeding, futuristic vaccine development, pharmaceuticals and advances in poultry nutrition. And we are providing training and education through Dr. B.B. Rao Institute of Poultry Management and Technology to the farmers and to the entrepreneurs. We have got a fully integrated business model. We have got pure line research program for broilers and for layers through which pedigree, grandparents, parents, and we are producing. We have got a nationwide network of franchises, and through them we are producing commercials, broiler commercials, and in fact, we have got two slaughter units and ready to cook products also. So we are selling through Venky's Express, and in layers, we are selling commercial layers and then table eggs, and even we have got the nutraceuticals and we have got the egg powder plant also for export purpose. In addition to that, we have got pharmaceuticals, vitamin premix plant. We have got a plant for biosecurity solutions, SPFX, poultry biologicals, and poultry equipment. And along with that, we have got companion animal health care unit, livestock health care and nutrition unit, and even we have got Blackburn Rovers football team. We are owning that company. We are owning that football team. We are having this training and education through B.B. Rao Institute of Poultry Management and Training. We are providing technical services to the farmers through PDRC and satellite labs. And we are also providing technical and extension services. And we have got one vaccine research and development center also. So poultry industry is facing various challenges. You see, now in the present context, we are facing a problem of bird flu. And it's because of annually we are getting migratory birds, and then through migratory birds we are getting various problems like bird flu. And in the context of challenging environment also, so there are a lot of changes in the environment nowadays, and we are getting a lot of rains in summer months also, or even in the winter also. Thereby the seasons, there is a lot of changes in the season temperature and even climate also. So because of this, we have got a lot of stress on the bird. And because of stress, there is always immune suppression, and the birds are susceptible to various diseases. And high disease pressure is always there because Indian poultry industry development is haphazard, and it's concentrated in few pockets like Tamil Nadu, Namakkal area, or if you take Barwala area, or if you take even in Andhra Pradesh also, or even in Telangana also, few pockets, they have got a huge population in limited area. Then that's why there is always a high disease pressure, and even farming practices also, because of high stocking density or in densely populated areas, there is always a high disease pressure. Secondly, recently we have got antibiotic resistant strains also, and there is always we are going through no human antibiotics are to be used for poultry, or there are restrictions to use antibiotics in poultry as a growth promoter. So there is always chances of getting infection and getting various bacterial infections, so that those challenges are always there. The poultry diseases, of course, it's a constant threat to poultry industry, because these pathogens, they are evolving. There are always mutations in the microbes, and they are becoming more pathogenic and more infectious. And of course, birds, their immune system is always vulnerable to stress. There are various stresses, managemental stresses, or stress because of nutrition, stress because of infectious agents, various infectious agents, So there are various immunosuppressive interactions, and because of this immunosuppressive interaction, definitely poultry diseases has become a constant threat to poultry industry. So in spite of all these threats and all these challenges, poultry industry is flourishing. Definitely we have got a lot of opportunities in poultry industry, and there are so many opportunities in diagnostic and technical services as a microbiologist or virologist, in vaccine production and R&D. As a pathologist or biotechnologist, you can work in R&D, in disease diagnosis or in vaccine production also. You can work in food safety and quality assurance. You can work in breeder company also. You can work in feed mills, nutrition and diet formulations. As a farm manager in farms, as a marketing person also you can work. You can work as a trainer, and you can give training in the field of management and disease diagnosis. You can work in the primary breeders company or hatcheries, even in biological companies, regulatory authorities you can work, pharmaceuticals also. There are a lot of opportunities for poultry specialist. Private, as a private consultant also you can work in feed company, or even as an academic person or extension worker in various NGOs you can work. As a public health worker also there is a lot of opportunities, because there are so many zoonotic diseases in poultry sectors, and then so there are a lot of opportunities in public health aspect also. So what's the role of diagnostic lab veterinarian? So he determines cause of disease through observations and laboratory analysis. He advises veterinarians about diseases detected in samples, tissues or fluids. And of course he performs biopsies or necropsies. Without that, he cannot do other work. So what is the role of diagnostic lab veterinarian? Basically, when he investigates some outbreak, he should collect a history of the flock. He should do a necropsy, and then based on the necropsy finding, and then he can give samples for histopathology, and based on these results, he can provide tentative diagnosis for flock problems. He can request for ancillary tests like bacteriology, virology, serology, toxicology, etc. And he may make field visits if necessary. Field necropsy and sample collection also he can do. And he can have a managemental observations also. And based on the all the observations, like depending on the histopathology or results of ancillary test and results of his observation, he can give final diagnosis and suggestions to the farmers. So at least he should have, before giving diagnosis, he should have a knowledge of common diseases or syndromes in poultry. So there are various viral diseases, bacterial diseases, fungal diseases, parasitic and protozoan diseases, mycotoxicoses, deficiency syndromes, feed related problems, or other managemental problems are always there. So if you consider the all these problems, managemental problems are basic problems, and because of managemental issues, many problems, other problems arise. So what are the viral diseases, common viral diseases in poultry? Newcastle disease, avian influenza, infectious bronchitis, ILT, pneumoviruses, IBD, CAB, fowl adenoviruses, MTEO viruses, leukosis viruses, reticular endotheliosis viruses, chicken astroviruses, avian encephalomyelitis, parvoviruses. There are so many things. And then again, old diseases are there bacterial diseases like salmonellosis, colibacillosis, fowl cholera, infectious coryza, IBM mycoplasmosis, or protozoan diseases like coccidiosis. These are very common diseases. And when we say about common diseases and diseases of poultry, we should not forget OIE, because OIE, they have specified certain diagnostic assays fit for the purpose. That means those diagnostic assays, they are having specific applications. That means certain diagnostic assays, they demonstrate freedom from infection in a defined population. Certain assays are definitely for trade purpose or before the movement of the birds, transboundary movement of the birds. So they specify freedom from infection or presence of the agent in individual animals or products. Then certain assays, they have specified for eradication of disease or elimination of infection from defined population. Certain assays confirm diagnosis of suspect or clinical cases. And for surveillance method, they assign certain diagnostic assays and to determine immune status of individual animals or populations post-vaccination, they assign certain diagnostic assays. So what are the key points for investigation of disease? When we ask how you investigate the disease outbreak, definitely the veterinarian should know flock history. Then he should examine the flock and he should examine the individual birds, and then he should do the postmortem, and then he can rule out the certain diseases. And then for confirmatory analysis, he can go for laboratory diagnostic test, and then he can give the confirmatory diagnosis, and then he can go for the control of diseases. First thing is flock history. So there are various questions he can ask regarding flock history to the farmer or owner of the farm, or the worker in the farm, supervisor or worker in the farm. And then he can examine the flock regarding how is the behavior of the flock, what is the consumption of the feed and water, and then is there any mortality or how is the morbidity, and then is there any dullness or is there any change in litter condition or so many things. And based on this examination of the flock, and then based on the examination of individual birds, he can decide how he can rule out the diseases. And then afterwards, he can do the postmortem. He can select the morbid birds or the fresh mortality for examination so that he can come to the conclusion. So, practical approaches for the diagnosis of poultry diseases is first is clinical diagnosis. Then he can do rapid field diagnostic test. There are certain tests like salmonella antigen test, beta-glutination test, or even for mycoplasma, beta-glutination test is there. So he can perform rapid field diagnostic test also. He can give samples for histopathology when he collect the samples from the necropsy. Then he should collect the samples for serology, blood samples. So he can give sera samples for analysis. Then molecular techniques also he can use for identification of microbes. Then isolation, identification, and characterization of pathogens. And of course, direct and indirect electron microscopy can be done. But the facilities are very limited in India, so it's almost negligible. The use of these methods is very negligible. So if you see the diagnosis based on clinical lesions, I'm just giving example of Newcastle disease virus. So it's causing lesions in trachea and then proventriculus. Proventriculus, it's typical pathognomic lesions in proventricular papillary lesions. papillary region. They have got hemorrhages over papillary hemorrhages, and then you can get the ulcers in the intestine and congestion in the brain. So there are certain pathognomonic lesions, but there is always avian respiratory disease complex. That means whatever we have learned in the books or in the classrooms, it's not sufficient. The disease is always definitely complex type. That means two or three pathogens can be present at a time. You cannot make anything out of these lesions. You can say that it can be a Newcastle disease, it can be a E. coli, it can be IB, or it can be ILT. There are so many things. So there are so many pathogens are involved in avian respiratory complex. Newcastle disease is there, avian influenza is there, infectious bronchitis is there, infectious laryngotracheitis is there, avian metapneumoviruses are there, infectious coryza caused by Haemophilus paragallinarum, ornithobacteriosis, Ornithobacterium rhinotricoel can be present, mycoplasmosis is there, fall cholera is there. So you have to differentiate. That's the important thing. So based on the gross lesions, it's very difficult to analyze the disease diagnosis. You cannot make the final diagnosis out of the gross lesions. So you have to take a help from the laboratory to analyze and to take a decision and to come to the certain conclusions. So these are all lesions you can get it in avian respiratory complex. So you have to make a differential diagnosis on the basis of clinical signs, symptoms, and gross lesions. It's very difficult to diagnose in some cases. And important to have the correct diagnosis, because you have to provide correct treatment and prevention program. You have to formulate prevention program of the disease. Even due to immunosuppression, you can see in Indian context, you can see chicken anemia virus outbreaks in commercial layer growers, and those cause immunosuppression in poultry. Even chicken adenoviruses in commercial layer growers, it can cause immunosuppression. There are various viruses which cause immunosuppression even in infectious bursal disease. Then IBH, adenoviruses, even rhinoviruses, they cause, even Marek's disease virus, it causes immunosuppression. And because of that immunosuppression, one thing has happened when we are vaccinating also, so it will suppress the immune response. That's why the birds are susceptible for that vaccination also. And then even for that, the disease for which the birds has been vaccinated, or for other diseases also. So immunosuppression is very major factor which is responsible for causing disease syndrome in birds. Even immunosuppression can be caused by nutritional factors or even by managemental factors if the bird has not been provided with the space which is required, or shifting is late, then definitely there is a crowding of birds, and then it leads to immunosuppression. Then afterwards you can get various diseases, viral or bacterial, and then definitely you will have more problems. So in this situation, identification of primary pathogen and at the same time treatment of secondary pathogens is very important. So when you perform the necropsy, then collection of material is very important. So you should have the list what material needs to be collected for which disease. That's very important. So proper collection of morbid materials from date or sick birds is of paramount importance. Then again, proper timing of sample collection, where you one should not collect samples from the dead birds, or even if some birds are putrefying, then at that time samples should not be collected. Samples should be collected from the morbid birds. That's very important. And even sometimes samples, if you collect in the course of time, suppose the disease outbreak has started 10 days back, and if you are collecting samples after 10 or 15 days, then you may not get the isolation, or you may not get the proper diagnosis. Then you should collect the samples early in the infection. It's very important. If you are collecting samples, suppose coryza is there, then collection of samples, it should be in early conditions. So after outbreak, within 2 to 3 days, you should collect the sample. Then only you can, you will be able to isolate the organism. So correct sample for choice for investigation is very important. Then second thing is sample size and pooling of the sample. Sample size is very much important, and even you cannot pool samples, large samples in one test tube or something like that. You should not do. So proper sample size you should maintain. Then how to collect the samples, proper method of sampling you should adopt. It should be collected in viral, suppose you are collecting for any virus isolation, it should be collected in viral transport medium. It should be sent to laboratory as soon as possible, and to be kept at suitable temperature. And for serological purpose, you are suppose you are collecting blood samples, then these samples should be paired serum samples. So you should collect samples from the acute cases, and then you can collect the samples from the convalescent birds, so that comparing these serological results, then you can decide about the outbreak. Then for histopathology purpose, you can collect samples from tissues and organs in 10% formalin. Then how to transport the sample? If it is for short distance, that means it is taking less than 1 hour, then you can use balanced salt solution or PBS, or you can use 50% GPBS also. And for long distance or longer period of time, then it should be frozen in frozen condition, ice flask or bags of at 4 degrees centigrade, or you can use the preservative like 50% glycerin, 10% DMSO or VTM also. That depends on the nature of virus or nature of microbe. Then serological surveillance, if you want to do, it's very important tool. You can have the monitor the flock health. For that, paired sera samples are required. A retrospective diagnosis can be made by serology. The detection of virus-specific antibodies in serum samples provides a convenient way of determining the extent of virus infection within animal population. It can be used as an adjunct to a diagnosis, but it is not a replacement for virus isolation. There are various serological tests like hemagglutination inhibition test, agar gel precipitation test, virus neutralization test, enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, immunofluorescence antibody test, immunoperoxidase test, Western blot, and rapid lateral flow kits, depending on the facilities available and depending on the standardization of the test, you can use those tests accordingly. There are certain OIE recommended tests are there, immunodiagnostic tests are there for IBD, AGID and ELISA, MD, AGID, avian mycoplasmosis, agglutination or HI, fall typhoid or Fularum disease, agglutination, infectious bronchitis, virus neutralization test, HI or ELISA. For ILT, AGID, BNT, ELISA, for avian influenza, AGID and HIR recommended test. For Newcastle disease, HI is recommended test. Of course, histopathology, which significantly contributes to an immediate diagnosis and narrows the further differential diagnosis process. So lesions characterized are pathognomic, suggestive, and non-specific lesions. You can always diagnose the tumors. You can differentiate those tumors like Marek's disease or avian leukosis virus. Differentiation is always there. Confirmatory diagnosis for detection of antigen in tissues. The process used is immunohistochemistry, immunofluorescence, tested, etc. And then formalin fixed paraffin embedded tissues can be used for extraction of DNA or RNA is always possible. And that DNA or RNA can be used for further analysis by PCR or other test. So for technical, for confirmatory diagnosis, you can always use, as I already told you, histopathology. In particularly, you can see this in infectious laryngotracheitis, you can get the intranuclear inclusion bodies. You can always notice. And then in adenoviruses also, you can get intranuclear inclusion bodies. They are very peculiar. And even fall pox, you can get intracytoplasmic Bollinger bodies. Those are inclusion bodies, intracytoplasmic inclusion bodies. These are very specific. And you can say that it's a confirmatory diagnosis for this disease. So there are various bacteriological diseases also, which are found in poultry, and certain diseases we can diagnose by cross lesions also. Coli bacillosis is very common disease. It can cause thick yellowish fibrinous layer covering the liver and other visceral organs. Then coli bacillosis can also cause subcutaneous hemorrhages also, and omphalitis, yolk sac infection, it can be caused by E. coli. And in fawn cholera, you can get the petechial hemorrhages over the pericardial fat. And then in fawn cholera chronic cases, you can get swollen vitals resulting from localized infection. And fall cholera, of course, liver, you can get the necrotic foci on the liver. Of course, again, it's not a pathognomic. You can get the necrotic foci in so many other conditions also, but you have to see the other factors or the clinical findings. Salmonella, you can see it's a typical bronzing of the liver. And you can see the necrotic foci on the liver, and then you can see the, even in gallbladder also, you can see the foci. It's a localized salmonellosis. It's a localized in eye. We have isolated salmonella from this eye, and even in liver also, you can get the patches which look similar to the Marek's disease also. Sometimes you can confuse with MD, but then you have to make a differential diagnosis, and even core in the ceca also, and even pedunculated ovary you can get. You can isolate the salmonella from these cases. Necrotic enteritis, you can see from the birds affected with the Clostridium or it's a clostridial infection, and even it's very important in the economic point of view, because it causes a lot of mortality, and even FCR got affected. Infectious coryza, you can see the unilateral or bilateral swelling of the eye, and it can be combined with E. coli also. So collection of sample should be done at proper timing. Otherwise, you can get the isolation of secondary organism, that is Escherichia coli. Bacterial investigation, you have to do isolation, identification, and characterization of bacterial organisms, isolation by selective media, differential media, enrichment media, etc. Then you have to see the cultural characteristics, whether it is aerobic, non-aerobic, motile, non-motile, fast-growing, slow-growing. Then you have to see the staining characteristic also, gram-positive, gram-negative, acid-fast or non-acid-fast, etc. And then selective staining for capsule, flagella, etc. And even antibiotic sensitivity test is very important, because based on that only you can select for the antibiotic. Some rapid diagnostic tests are there. Here you can notice it's a negative, and then this is a positive Salmonella plate test, positive. You can see the agglutination of RBCs here. And again, it has been carried out in serum. It's very, you can see the agglutination pattern very easily. Then again, biochemical characterization of bacterial agents is very important. Biochemical profiling like IMVIC test, indole test, methyl red, August Proskauer or citrate test are important, and various other tests like catalase and coagulase test also can be carried out. Again, CRD. CRD is very common in poultry because E. coli is always there, and mycoplasma free flocks are very rare. And because of our farming practices, when we don't have single age group flocks or single age group farms, then definitely mycoplasma is a general resident of the farm. So when we get mycoplasma, definitely along with it, you can get E. coli infections. And there are various other complicating factors also, like infectious bronchitis and Newcastle disease. Those viruses are always cause secondary complications. So these are the gross lesions of CRD. And when we consider mycoplasma, it's very nasty microorganism. Cell wall is not there. It's pleomorphic and needs special media for growth. And for isolation and characterization, specific dedicated facilities are required to avoid contamination. And there are several species of mycoplasma there, but for us, important species are Mycoplasma gallisepticum and Mycoplasma cyanovae. Cyanovae causes tendons, inflammation, and you can get the swollen joints also. When you do fungal investigation, there's isolation, identification, and characterization of fungal organisms we should do. It's aspergillosis is very important. You can see these aspergillus nodules in lungs and air sacs in young chicks, young broilers or young layer chicks. And you can see this when we grow on saprods, dextrose, agar, and even in particularly even in histopathology also you can see, and in special strains like Rocott strains, you can see the hyphae, and even in HNE staining of histopathology, you can see the hyphae and hyphae present in the bronchi. When we do virus isolation, we do it in embryonated chicken eggs by various methods, like amniotic method, or karyolytic membrane methods, or allantoic method. So amniotic inoculation you can do, then yolk sac inoculation you can do, then allantoic inoculation you can do. You can propagate the virus in primary cell cultures like chicken embryo fibroblast, chicken embryo liver cells, or tracheal organ culture also you can do. Secondary cell cultures also you can perform. Certain cell lines like MSB1 cell line, you can use it for the propagation of chicken anemia virus also. So there are various cell lines also, and primary cell cultures, of course, you can use for specific viruses isolation. And lastly, you can do the animal inoculations for isolation of viruses. Particularly, you can use specific pathogen-free chicks so that, again, you can re-isolate the virus or the pathogen from those chicks. Molecular biology offers a wide range of new methods for rapid diagnosis. Different assays are there. Conventional gel-based PCR assays are there. Multiplex diagnostic PCR assays are there. Loop-mediated isothermal amplification, that is LAMP, is there. Real-time PCR, microarrays, DNA sequencing, next-generation sequencing, metagenomics. So many techniques are available for molecular diagnosis. Molecular techniques are able to accelerate and improve the diagnosis of poultry diseases. So what are the advantages of molecular diagnosis? The methods are very sensitive, they are highly specific, and because of high speed, we can come to the diagnosis within few hours, and there is no limit for detecting new or atypical organisms. So this is conventional polymerase chain reaction. We can use for DNA viruses, we can use for conventional PCR or qPCR. For RNA viruses, we can use RT-PCR or qRT-PCR, reverse transcriptase PCR or qRT-PCR, PCR or multiplex PCR, we can use for detection of various viruses at a time. Real-time PCR. So several variants for real-time PCR methods and chemistries are used today. The advantages of real-time PCR over classical or conventional PCR are they are faster and higher throughput assays. Post-PCR handling of the products is not needed. They are very sensitive. Quantitative assays are more accurate. They can be performed in less time. They are very practical to automate, and they are very suitable for multiplex PCR systems. There are various chemistries in real-time PCR like DNA binding dyes, Tachman probes, molecular beacons, scorpion primers. Tachman probe chemistry is most sensitive technique and most commonly used in diagnosis and quantification. But the principle of real-time PCR is the probe. This is the probe. The probe has two fluorescent dyes, that is reporter dye and the quencher dye, which are attached to 5' end and 3' end respectively. During each extension cycle, tagged DNA polymerase cleaves reporter dye from the probe, and fluorescence is evolved. So once separated from the quencher, the reporter dye emits its fluorescence, and fluorescence intensity increases with each cycle as more fluorochrome is released and which is measured. So this is real-time PCR amplification plot. So this is positive control, and these are samples, positive samples, and this is negative control. The CT value is the PCR cycle in which fluorescence passes a fixed threshold value. So this is the CT value. Process of determining the nucleotide orders is the DNA sequencing. DNA sequence can separate microbes at least at genus level, and is mostly used in microbial identification and after broad range PCR. So methods of DNA sequencing are chain termination method, that is Sanger's method, chemical degradation method, that is Maxim or Gilbert method, next generation sequencing is there, so pyro sequencing, ion torrent or Illumina techniques are there. So what are the applications of gene sequencing? It characterizes the pathogens at genomic levels. It detects the variants, biological properties of the genes, and then phylogenetic analysis also can highlight the close relations among or within the families of virus and the low, moderate, or extreme genetic variability among the isolates worldwide can be measured. So this is the DNA sequence electrofluorogram view. So once we get this electrofluorogram in the AP machine, analyzer machine, then this fluorogram can be put in Mega or DNA Star software. So analysis of sequencing data and the construction of phylogenetic tree for percent identity, variation or mutations can be done. So this is the end result we got after analysis of sequencing of adenoviruses, so that we can have different isolates. We can measure the variation or percent identity within the isolates. So this is serotype 11, serotype 2, serotype 6, serotype 4, serotype 9, or serotype 8B. Metagenomics. Sequencing of DNA extracted from environmental samples is called as metagenomics. Metagenomic and deep sequencing techniques can detect unknown agents, so it is also called as pathogen mining. Many laboratories are applying this technology to virus discovery. So it is the latest technique. So how we can come to clinical diagnosis of a disease based on the virus label or based on the antibody label? So if you take the virus or antibody label and days post-infection or post-challenge, then initially virus multiplies very rapidly and then the labels goes down. And antibody production starts at the, maybe at the 7 days, and again it rises and it can come down slowly. So various rapid field tests can be done when the virus labels are picked. So you can do the QRT-PCR and virus isolation maybe up to 21 to 28 days. And beyond that, definitely we may not get any viruses. Isolation or even QRT-PCR may be negative. And for antibody detection, you can use ELISA or HI or any method for antibody detection after 7 days, and you can get a good antibody detection at 15 to 21 days, and again, it will go down. So what are the limitations of laboratories? Proper sampling or contaminated sample, if you receive, then definitely proper diagnosis you cannot give. Selection of diagnostic test is very important. And then for emerging and re-emerging pathogens, definitely you have to standardize the test, and then only then you can use those tests. Then carrier contamination, that's very important, and you should take care of that. Sometimes false positive or false negative reactions are also seen in agglutination or even in other tests also, even in PCR also. So then those issues also you should solve. Cross-reactivity between the different viruses or antibodies is always there. So you have to definitely take care of cross-reactivity, or you should know those things. And then lastly, cost of reagent, consumables, lab-to-lab differences. Those things are there, and then by comparing with other labs, or even by using the standard test from the other labs, you can compare and then come to certain conclusion. So what we are doing diagnosis of avian diseases at PDRC. So we are doing cross pathology, histopathology, microbiology, nutrition analysis, serology and ELISA, molecular biology, and antibiotic and pesticide residue, viral isolations and detections. So all these things we are doing at PDRC. So diagnostic steps, what we are following at PDRC: sample collection and processing, then nucleic, then we are subjecting these samples to nucleic acid extraction, then detection of antigen by PCR, qPCR, RT-PCR, qRT-PCR, then step four is isolation and identification in embryonated SPFX, cell culture or media. Then step five, what we are doing is confirmation by PCR, qPCR, and then of course we are doing gene sequencing and analysis for whether there is any mutation or something like that, and in vivo pathogen we are carrying out, and even challenge studies also we are carrying out. Nutrition laboratory, of course, 70% of production cost is on feed. Even the slight variation in quality of feed ingredients or feed affects the performance of poultry. Wide variability observed in nutrient content of the raw materials. And we can check for the microbial contamination of feed, oxidation of oils and fats, multiple mycotoxins, pesticides, insecticides, and fungicides contamination also we can check. So nutrition lab is useful to the poultry farmers in various ways by analysis of raw material, compound feed samples, premix and other mineral mixture products, oils, for its nutritional composition. Ultimately, feed analytical laboratory aids to improve poultry performance. Genetics and breedings, of course, it's very important and it's a basic thing. The development of genetically superior stocks capable of higher production, even under adverse climatic conditions, has transformed poultry industry from rural farming to full-fledged industry within 30-35 years. In poultry, genetic progress created in pair lines is disseminated through a comprehensive cross-breeding program that impacts large numbers of commercial layers and broilers in India. So this is all interrelated. Management, nutrition, infection, environment, these are all interrelated. If there is any change in all these factors, then definitely we can have infection or economic losses in poultry. So first thing is there is no substitute for good management. So if there is increased stocking density, vaccination problems, faulty brooding conditions, improper handling of birds, excess dust, wet litter, noise, these are all factors considered as a stress factors to the poultry. Even microbial or virus challenges, gut dysbacteriosis, mycotoxins, toxic metals, low water, toxic metals in feed, feed or water deprivation, quality, water quality problems, even rancidity or oxidized fat used in feed. Then sometimes environmental factors like inadequate temperature, inadequate ventilation, excess lighting. These can all cause infections in birds or secondary complications, and it will have impact on the economics of the poultry farming. So the conclusions of my presentation is definitely we have a lot of opportunities in the poultry industry. We are facing a lot of problems, we are facing a lot of threats, but still the poultry industry, Indian poultry industry, is growing at 7-10% every year, and it's contributing more than 1% at GDP level. So it's a lot of opportunities are there at Indian level also, and even internationally if we see, there are a lot of opportunities are there. Even though diagnosis process is not simple and it is extremely dynamic and rapidly changing field, different tests have different advantages and disadvantages. Combined approach is necessary to fully understand the clinical picture, and it is very important that field veterinarians and laboratory professionals, if they work together to solve the field problems, then only poultry industry can thrive. Thank you very much. Thank you for your kind attention. You are muted, Dr. Siddharth.
I'm sorry again. I was saying something, sir. Thank you, sir, for a very highly elaborative presentations. I mean, the kind of work which you are all doing, it's marvelous. And I think like there is a lot of things from you to learn for us. And there are a few questions, sir. And one important question has come from Mr. Dr. Simrandeep Singh. He is interested to ask you, like, are there any big diagnostic company like Thyrocare and Lalpath Labs in the veterinary side? And if not, then is there any kind of service in the field practices? What is the scope of this? And what is your views? What is the kind of a venture? Is beneficial or not? What prerequisites are required for start up this kind of ventures? So if you have any suggestions, please give it to them, because they are looking forward to venture into this kind of profession, actually.
Actually, if you consider poultry industry, Indian poultry industry, only PDRC is having this comprehensive diagnostic services. So we have got these diagnostic facilities, as I have already described, within all fields. So to have the comprehensive diagnostic testing facility, it's very time consuming. And then it's a capital investment is always very high. So definitely before venturing, he should have proper experience in poultry diagnosis and R&D, then only he can go for such kind of venture. And again, this facility, where it should be located, actually it should be nearby poultry pocket, so that the farmers in that poultry pocket will get benefited. Like Thyrocare and other diagnostic labs in humans. So it's very difficult to have such kind of chain in poultry diagnostic area.
I think, like, sir, you said, like, you, I mean, I also know, because I have also worked with you, and I have also worked with Venkateshwar actually previously. And you know, like the satellite labs which you have, it's one of the unique kind of program which you have started, and probably like this kind of programs are great beneficial to the local farmers. And the way you are providing the services to them, the veterinary services, I think like they are as equitable to the kind of services which are being given by Thyrocare and other labs in the field of veterinary science, in the field of human science, sir. So yeah.
Actually, it's a unique model. We have got a 33 satellite laboratories. They are equipped with one or two veterinarians. So satellite laboratories, they collect the samples, they do the initial work, such as water testing or feed microbiology testing, and they send the samples to zonal laboratories, and then from zonal laboratories they send the samples to the nodal laboratory, that is PDRC. At zonal laboratory they do some work. But isolation of viruses, definitely we have to do the isolation of viruses, etc. One more thing is, most of the services we are offering, they are free of cost. Our parent company, that is Venkateshwara Hatcheries Private Limited, they are bearing all the cost. That means any farmer, whether he is having our bird or even competitor birds, he can bring the birds to the lab and he can get the birds tested. So that is not an issue. So such kind of model, if anybody brings, it's very difficult, because it's a lot of investment is there. And since it's a very big group, it's possible for VH, but otherwise it's very difficult.
And another thing, sir, I think like this student, they are also interested to know like is Venkateshwar Hatchery is going for some kind of campus interview on a regular basis? Because people, you know, like some of students, they are very much interested to get into this kind of well-established poultry business, like poultry sector. They want to, they want to just share up their knowledge, whatever they have gained during their graduation days and post-graduation days. So they want to be a part of the company. So what is the mechanism? Is there is any mechanism, regular mechanism is there for recruitment process?
Definitely. We generally don't go for campus interview, etc. But they can submit their resumes to the HR manager at Pune. And if somebody wants, he can collect the resumes from the HR manager at Pune.
Right. Sir, there is another small question again from Simrandeep Singh. He is asking, what is the time lapse between reception of sample and the test results? How you manage this with a minimum fault?
I could not get that question actually.
I think like he is asking about like the collection of samples which you have suggested, like people they are collecting the samples.
Collection of samples, of course, collection of samples and performance of tests.
Yeah.
That depends on the how the samples are presented to the laboratory. Suppose the distance is, suppose from the north, they are giving samples and we have to perform the test at Pune. Then it takes almost 4 to 5 days sometimes, because sample has to come from courier service or somebody has to bring the sample. So in that meantime, they should store the samples properly, managing proper temperature, temperature conditions, and even the storage media. So as per the requirement, they should store in proper media and proper temperature, freezing temperature should be maintained.
Okay. So I think like right now, no other questions are there. There is no flashing of questions. I will request again, students, do you have any questions? Please put on some questions. If you have any doubt, please come up with your questions. It's a wonderful juncture for you to ask, because Dr. Chawak, he is a well-experienced person in this field and he can guide you. With that, sir, I think like nobody has any questions, major question. With this note, sir, I thank you for giving us
Sir, my question is about that, how you manage the financials, how you keep that transport at lowest cost possible?
Even you can submit samples on FTA cards also. If you want to detect the samples, if you want to detect the pathogen, then you can submit the sample on FTA card also, so that temperature and other media problem and other things will not be there. But in that case, only detection is possible. Isolation and further characterization is not possible. So you can maintain the lower cost by using FTA cards.
Is it clear, Simrandeep?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So I thank Dr. Chawak for spending valuable time of his busy schedule to us to deliver a nice lecture on poultry industry, as well as the different, I would say, like diseases which are prevalent in the poultry sector. And also, like he also talked about the latest techniques which are being used for identifying the pathogen and then classifying them at their genomic level. It is really a wonderful lecture for all of us. And we have learned a lot of things from you, sir. And I think like it will be beneficial for our students. They would apply your lectures in the days to come for their career. So with that, I wish you a great good day, a great good year in coming times.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, before I leave, sir, I would like to tell one more thing. Like for this session, I had a cooperation from Dr. Omar Khalil Baba. He has joined us as an assistant professor recently. And in addition to him, Dr. Vishal Mahajan, he is a senior scientist. He has also contributed in the arrangement of this lecture for students, sir. So with that note, I say thank you to all of you of participating in it. And once again, sir, I thank you for giving us a valuable time for your lecture, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.